It's time to look over some blockheaded moments in animation. I've already covered my top 10 favorite Peanut specials a while back. Now it's time to look at the flip side of the coin. These are what I consider the top 5 worst Peanut specials ever released. Whether it's through irritating characters or just lackluster writing, these are the specials that just make you go with no hesitation. I was considering making this a top 10 list, but I couldn't find that many that I considered truly terrible, so these are pretty much the worst of the worst. Introductions aside, let's count them down. Number 5. Happy New Year, Charlie Brown. Looking for something on TV to enjoy over your New Year's holiday? Look elsewhere. This special sees Charlie Brown having to read War and Peace and write a book report on it over the winter vacation. Yeah, I remember having to do such a book report back in my elementary school days. Oh wait, no I didn't. Charlie Brown is unhappy with how long the book is and how much work the report will be, but Linus jumps in and says,
"When Leo Tolstoy was writing War and Peace, his wife Sonia copied it for him 7 times. She wrote the book 7 times with a dip pen. And you're telling me you can't even read it once?"
So, why aren't you doing the assignment yourself then, Linus? You were clearly in the room with Charlie Brown when it was assigned, and yet I don't see you poring over the text like he is. Things keep happening to draw Charlie Brown away from his work. Mainly, the New Year's Eve party that Marcy and Peppermint Patty are throwing. Peppermint Patty invites Charlie Brown over, oblivious to his explanation about the assignment, and tells him that he can invite someone special. He decides to invite the little red-haired girl, and he goes over to her house to give her the invitation. I'm not kidding, he actually delivers the invitation to her himself. Charlie Brown decides to bring his War and Peace book with him to the party. After varying activities, he finally has some downtime to read, but he falls asleep on the front porch. When he wakes up and goes back inside, Peppermint Patty angrily asks why he didn't dance with her and wonders where he went, despite the fact that she left him out on the front porch in the first place. Sally is upset with him too, because Linus danced with the little red-haired girl instead of her. Yeah, instead of taking the time to look for Charlie Brown, Linus dances with his girl. Instead of taking the time to beat the crap out of his so-called friend, Charlie Brown looks out into the night after he learns the girl of his dreams is gone. That expression on his face really says it all, doesn't it?
Happy New Year, Charles!
In the end, after Charlie Brown hands his assignment in, he receives a D- for his work. Then Linus tells him the next assignment.
To read Crime and Punishment by Dostoevsky. Happy New Year, Charlie Brown.
Great way to ring in the new year, huh? I was really disappointed in this special. With the good New Year's strips from the comics, you'd figure a Peanut special centered on the holiday would be at least decent, but no. I know that losing is a big part of Peanuts, but this just went too far for me. Everything served to escalate Charlie Brown's misery here, and what few happy moments he had were short-lived. Maybe if the special had him actively procrastinate on the assignment like the story from the comic strips did, it would have worked a little better. What really stings about this, though, is how unlikable they made Linus. You normally can trust him to be Charlie Brown's confidant, but stealing the little red-haired girl and describing the great time he had with her to Charlie Brown just really drives me up the wall. If you're looking for a great Peanuts holiday special, find a different one. Number 4. It's Your First Kiss, Charlie Brown. I think it's pretty safe to say that this is the first Peanuts special where things went wrong. Even way back when it first aired in 1977, viewers were quick to point out the major problem with it, which I will get to. It's the date of the homecoming game at Charlie Brown's school, and Charlie Brown and all the guys are escorts. Wait, isn't homecoming celebrated by high schoolers? You know what? That's not the main problem here, let's ignore it. Anyway, Charlie Brown looks ahead to the float in front of him and sees the little red-haired girl, making her first on-screen appearance. Linus tells him that as her escort, he is to give her a kiss before the first dance. On hearing this, Charlie Brown faints and falls off the float. This image pretty much gives you an idea of what the main problem with this special is. Keep it in mind. Not only are they escorts, Charlie Brown and his friends are also playing in the football game. Charlie Brown is the designated kicker and Lucy holds the football for him. if you know Peanuts, you know how this is gonna end up. Look, as funny as the football gags are, there's a time and a place for everything, yet it's not here or now. The most stupid thing about this is that whenever Lucy pulls the football away and Charlie Brown misses the kick, it's Charlie Brown who gets blamed for the botched play. I get that the gimmick of the strip is that Charlie Brown loses or fails in games, at flying a kite, etc., but there's a key thing that's been forgotten. When Charlie Brown loses or fails at something, it's generally due to unforeseen circumstances or Charlie Brown's own misfortune. That's what can make it funny. It doesn't work when somebody else is clearly involved. Nobody likes seeing someone get blamed unfairly. Audiences weren't happy about this when it first aired and let the producers know about it, so some dialogue from the special was removed to make it seem less mean, but the unfair blame towards Charlie Brown can still be felt.
Out who our Zero is.
After the game, and in spite of the humiliating loss, Charlie Brown still shows up at the homecoming dance, but he has to endure the berating of Lucy and Peppermint Patty.
After you lost today's game, this is the last place we thought you'd be.
Yeah, you've got some nerve, Charlie Brown. Who'd want to be your date after today's game?
Okay, Charlie Brown was not at fault for losing the game. I know that even in a spectator sport like football, some things may slip under the radar, but I cannot believe that something that took place with each and every kickoff would go missed for the entirety of the game. It's pure idiocy if you can't tell that Charlie Brown wasn't at fault for the kickoffs. And in Lucy's case, because she's blaming Charlie Brown for something that was clearly her fault, it's hypocrisy. Now the dance begins, and it's time for Charlie Brown and his friends to escort the queen and her court. Everything moves in slow motion as Charlie Brown nervously makes his way towards the little red-haired girl, until... here comes the fantasy sequence. He eventually wakes up and goes outside where he meets Linus. Linus tells him that although the game was a disaster, Charlie Brown really got the party started at the dance when he swept the little red-haired girl and the other girls off their feet. Unfortunately, Charlie Brown doesn't seem to remember any of this.
What good is it to do anything, Linus, if you can't remember what you did?
Kid, if you ever get into heavy drinking, that could become a commonplace feeling. This special isn't so bad if you can look past the travesty of the football game, but points do need to come off for it. Just blaming Charlie Brown for what goes wrong is unfair. He doesn't deserve berating for every disaster. I guess I should count my blessings, as Charlie Brown does get something good out of this, even if he couldn't remember much of it. And there are worse specials out there than this one, believe me. Number 3. Someday you'll find her, Charlie Brown. Ah, boy, this one. In my top 10 best Peanut specials list, I highlighted some specials that deal with the theme of romantic pursuits and heartbreak. I thought they did a good job with the subject matter in spite of what miserable circumstances there were, but here's how you do one of those specials the wrong way. So, Charlie Brown is watching a football game when suddenly... you know, I think there's a good rule of thumb to establish here. If a special begins with Charlie Brown becoming all choked up and red over a girl, I can guarantee you it'll be below average. It's not funny, and all subsequent events are equally irritating. So, Charlie Brown tells Linus about the girl he's just seen, and then laments that he'll never see her again when the game ends. The next day, Charlie Brown tells Linus that they have to find this girl. Snoopy and Woodstock accompany them to the stadium where the game was. After recreating the shot with Linus, Charlie Brown asks Linus to go to the ticket booth and ask who sat in those seats. They are redirected to the season ticket office. Again, Charlie Brown asks Linus to find out who sat in the seats. This is par for the course in this special. Charlie Brown asks Linus to do everything for him, all the while standing by and sweating and shaking profusely. He comes across as so weak and spineless in this special that it's hard for me to sympathize with him, which is what I think this special wants us to do. The rest of this special sees Charlie Brown and Linus going to varying houses across town to try to find Charlie Brown's beloved. Each time, Charlie Brown gets Linus to do all the talking as he stands by and signals for a hit or miss. After Charlie Brown gives a no at two houses, they're directed to a place pretty far out of town. A rather mean bobcat lives there and chases the two boys, as well as Snoopy and Woodstock, off the property. After being directed to another entrance by phone, Linus goes up to the house to do the talking for Charlie Brown, only this time... Linus falls for the girl. He notes that they have something in common when he sees her security blanket, and they both go in and talk. However, Linus has been unaware of Charlie Brown's signals, and as it turns out...
Linus, she's the one!
After a long period of time, Linus comes out, and Charlie Brown learns that he has fallen in love with this girl. I'm not sure if I'm supposed to be angry at Linus or not, but with the exchange that goes on here, I can't help but laugh at some of these lines. Finally, Charlie Brown runs off and...
Sometimes I feel...
Oh, no! You're not doing this, are you?
When every playful bird in flight is...
So now we get a sad sack depressing song, which ends with Charlie Brown waking up the next morning and finding Snoopy waiting for his breakfast. Then Charlie Brown meets Linus at the wall and tells him how crushed he feels. Linus appears to sympathize with him until he checks the time and tells Charlie Brown about how he's been invited to that girl's house for a barbecue, much to Charlie Brown's annoyance.
"'Tis better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all."
Okay, I understand the special was trying to say that you're not always going to win someone's affections in the end, but the way it played out really served to muddy that message. It's great that Linus is willing to help Charlie Brown in his romantic pursuit, but just because you're aiding the search doesn't mean you get fair claim to the person yourself. It ends up making Linus look like the bad guy at the end for stealing Charlie Brown's girl. Charlie Brown is quick to reprimand Linus for this, but after all that led up to it, I can't really sympathize with him either. The way he's acting so weak and pitiful is carried out to an excessive degree here. If you do that, even to a good friend trying to help, people will be irritated by you and push you away. So, I can't really root for anyone in this special. It goes from being irritating to depressing. I never got much joy out of watching it. The special is called Someday You'll Find Her, but the way things unfold and how miserable it becomes, it feels like... Well, I'll let Creedence Clearwater Revival say it for me. Number 2. A big problem Peanuts specials have had since the 1970s is that the plots don't have nearly enough material to cover the whole half hour, so the story needs to be stretched thin and loaded with filler. Nowhere is this more apparent than with this special. It was my best birthday ever, Charlie Brown. The special opens with Linus rollerblading. He does some neat tricks, we see him race by Pigpen, and we get close-ups of his legs, which I'm sure were rotoscoped. I hope you like this badly edited scene, because it shows up two more times, and each time it plays for a full minute. That may not sound like much, but when you take into account that the whole special is 24 minutes long, that means that literally 1/8 of it is taken up by Linus rollerblading. But that's not the only filler scene. He goes to a party. We see him dancing, along with several of the other Peanuts characters as well. It's never explained whose party it is. In fact, after it ends, Charlie Brown asks Sally how it was, despite the fact that he was there himself, and she doesn't seem to remember who it was for or if it was a birthday party. So 6 minutes of this special have gone by, make that 7, and nothing useful has happened. After another stupidly long rollerblading scene, Linus stops in front of a gate where he hears some singing. He takes off his rollerblades and looks inside the gate where he sees a garden. Wandering through it, he finds that the singing is coming from a young girl. She's got quite a mature voice for her age, huh? This is Mimi. She's visiting her grandmother for a few days and is tending her garden. Linus helps her for a bit, and then Mimi begins talking about flowers.
"Mother says that she's had hollyhocks in her garden since she was a little girl. Did you know that they came all the way from China? I love foxgloves too. Did you know they used to make a heart medicine out of them? I think I like pansies best, because they look like little faces.
Oh my god, who the hell cares?
Look, I liked learning about gardening as much as the next guy, but we've got to get to a story here. After that pointless scene, Linus and Mimi sit down and begin talking over lemonade. Linus mentions that he's got a birthday coming up and invites Mimi. She accepts. He can't get her off his mind and goes through the next day doing stupid and embarrassing things. Kind of like Charlie Brown with the little red-haired girl. The day of the party comes and Linus waits at the door for all the kids to arrive. Everyone comes except Mimi. He continues waiting, anxious for her arrival. Quite a long time passes with Linus still waiting. Lucy and Sally bring out the cake and everyone begins singing Happy Birthday. Linus protests this, saying his guest of honor hasn't arrived yet, but they still continue singing. That is, until we hear a beautiful voice coming from outside.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Linus. Happy birthday to you.
She gives him a flower and a kiss and then leaves. Some star guest. She never indicated that she would have trouble making it or that she couldn't stay. The conflict here is completely forced. After she leaves, Linus dances energetically and everyone else joins in. The next day, Linus tells Charlie Brown all about it and wonders if he'll ever hear her song again. He gets his wish when he hears Woodstock whistling, which sounds like high notes being played on a synthesizer, and that's the end. Yeah, what shoots this special right into the top two is the fact that little to no effort was put into it. The others at least took the time to tell some kind of story. There was so much filler in this one that I doubt it would even run for 11 minutes if the editor had even done his job. This is one of the few specials that was released solely on VHS and never aired on primetime. And for good reason. It's one of those that makes you wonder whether or not the people behind it even cared. If you care, you'll do yourself and your friends and family a favor by skipping this one.
And now for some dishonorable mentions.
Number one worst peanut special of all time is It's the Girl in the Red Truck, Charlie Brown. My friends, you're witnessing the moment where the peanut specials jump the shark. There's no better way I can describe this special. No worst of peanuts list would be complete without it. It boggles the mind that something like this would come out of the imagination of Charles M. Schulz. As you can tell, this special is a lumbering mixture of live action and animation, which looks awkward and unconvincing. While that is a problem with the special, it's not the only one this train wreck has. The animated character in these live action shots is Spike, Snoopy's desert-dwelling brother. We learn about him through a letter to Snoopy, which Charlie Brown reads. With the exception of them, no other major Peanuts characters appear in this at all. Despite this being a Charlie Brown special, he's barely in this. After narrating the beginning, he and Snoopy completely disappear from it. We learn that Spike likes to sit by the road and wave to a girl who drives a red truck. I wonder where the title of this special came from. One day, by chance, her truck breaks down beside him. Despite not knowing anything about truck repair, Spike looks under the hood and when it comes crashing down on him, the truck is magically fixed.
Hey, we did it!
Jenny takes him into town, where we are met with the special's other problems. They go into a diner where they meet with Jenny's friend Molly. Nothing of substance happens here. Like It Was My Best Birthday, so many scenes in this just drag on, and some could have been edited out entirely. This could have easily been made into a half-hour special, but apparently someone thought this was good enough to make into a double-length feature. They go to Jenny's house, where she gives Spike a box of dog biscuits and she makes popcorn. Then her boyfriend Jeff comes by. He got Jenny a dancing audition in a movie. Despite having this big opportunity, Jenny refuses to leave her job as an aerobics dancer.
Ken, do you really want to spend the rest of your life out here in the desert teaching aerobics?
It's not the aerobics that are keeping me here, Jeff. You know that.
Yep, she says she has everything she loves right here in the desert. Honestly, I feel like I'm watching a 45-minute MetLife commercial. Next, they all go to the local skating rink where they rendezvous with Molly. In another scene that goes on way longer than necessary, Jenny shows off her skating moves and dances with Spike. She accidentally flings him out the door and he gets locked out. Jeff asks her for a dance, and feeling ignored, Spike leaves. He wanders away to find some stray dogs playing music. He joins in and they play together until gunfire from coyote hunters causes them to scatter. Meanwhile, Jenny and Jeff, searching for Spike, see the coyote hunters and follow them, because Jenny thinks that's where he went. How quickly we make the right connections. They see Spike on a ledge where the gunfire is directed and— Oh yeah, that's safe! Don't bother calling for a ceasefire, just risk your own life and climb up the rocks they're firing at. Every human in this film is an idiot. The hunters go away, and when Spike is rescued, Jenny thanks Jeff for his heroic actions. They offer to take Spike home, but he refuses and walks off into the night. The special ends with Jeff apologizing about the audition, and Spike makes his way back to his cactus home. Well, that was pointless. They take a great risk in thinking outside the box in this special, but if it does anything right, it's showing that sometimes it's best to stick to your strengths, which runs contrary to that phrase. The clumsy animation, second-rate acting, and pointless, meandering plot should make it clear why this special is better off forgotten. While it's not on the same level as certain other live-action animated films, it's not much better. It's hard to determine who would really like this. Peanuts fans won't, it hardly features any of the major characters. Adults will find it too stupid and campy, and kids will probably be bored or at least weirded out by it. Even if it had better writing, it would still be off-putting. Charlie Brown and his friends are what made the comics and most of the TV specials so enjoyable. When they have no significant part in them and focus on the adults, it doesn't make sense to call it a Charlie Brown special. That's the worst thing about this special. It's just not a Peanuts special. It doesn't deserve to have Charlie Brown's name in the title. Maybe it deserves to be buried in the same landfill that copies of the E.T. video game now reside in, but I won't make that call. It's not worth your time to watch this, and in my opinion, neither are the other specials that I've highlighted. If you do like these, I'm glad you can find something to enjoy about them that I can't. One thing I don't want to do is discourage you from enjoying Charlie Brown and the Peanuts Gang on television. He has his moments, good and bad. I guess it's just a matter of finding the specials where the good outweighs the bad.